Hello, everyone, and thanks for attending the Open Environmental Restoration Resource webinar on Navy Munitions Response Program Update on Guidance, Tools, and Templates to Execute the Program. My name is Anthony Nelson. I'm going to be your moderator for today. Before we get started, there are a couple things I'd like to go over. During the presentation, you participants are going to be in a listen-only mode. If you have any questions, please feel free to use the chat box on the bottom of your screen. Questions will be answered at the end of the presentation during the Q&A session, given that we have enough time. This presentation is being recorded, and an archive of the presentation will be sent out and available to the attendees after this call. During the call, we're going to be using some polling questions. When these pop up, just select the answer, submit the button, and be sure after the results are shown that you close that window. Otherwise, you won't get back into the slide deck and you won't be able to follow along. So remember, after the poll, close it. Once this webinar is ended, you will be prompted to complete a short survey. Please fill these out for us. We really rely upon this feedback, and it's important for us to keep the webinars relevant. Also, the survey will ask if you would like to be added to our T2 update email that gives information on all future webinar opportunities. Lastly, just a little disclaimer here, as I'll summarize for you, is the seminar is intended to be informational. It does not indicate endorsement of a particular product by the Department of Defense or by NAVFAC XWIC. We make every attempt to really make sure that this is accurate information, but really no guarantees here that any technology or product will be suitable for your project. So as always, this participation in these webinars is voluntary. Well, let me introduce our speakers today. We have two of them. Mr. Brian Hara is an environmental engineer from NAVFAC XWIC in Port Hueneme, California. His duties have exposed him to various innovative remediation technologies, including remediation of small arms range, landfill covers, perchloric contaminated groundwater, coastal contaminants, mitigation monitoring, and advanced geophysical classifications for munitions response. Mr. Hari has a BS in chemical engineering. Our second speaker is Station Martin. He's a physical scientist from our NAVFAC LANT office with the Viegas Restoration Section. He has experience directly managing both munitions response and insulation restoration program sites as an RPM. Currently, he provides munitions response and technical support across the Navy. Now, Ms. Martin has a BS in geology. Next, I'd like to pass this over to our headquarters representative, Gennady Coghlan, who will present a very short commentary on HQ's perspective on these webinars. Gennady?
Thank you, Tony. Thank you, everyone. I would like to emphasize how important it is to have a sustaining interest on the OER2 webinars. The webinar series, I think this is on our third year, is one of a main venue for us to communicate the latest and greatest policies, guidance, lesson learned on the environmental restoration program for Department of the Navy. And we rely on all of you, RPMs, managers, contractors, or anyone who are interested in our program to actively participate. So if you have any topics, please work with the RPMs so then any lesson learned on our programs can be shared with everyone. And as Tony mentioned, this is voluntary, and I also would like to remind everyone that at the end of the webinar, your feedback is so important because that's the only way that we will know how to maintain and improve the quality and relevancies of these webinar series. And the munition response topics is very important. As you know, Department of the Navy has a vast and large portfolio on munition response sites, both terrestrial and underwater. So I'm so excited to have Brian and Stacey, both of our SMEs, in this webinar today. Brian, I'm turning it on to you.
Thanks, Gennady. So our particular topic today for this webinar is we're going to be talking about the Munitions Response Program and giving an update on guidance, tools, and templates to execute the program. And so I'm going to talk to you about some of those guidance, tools, and templates. And then Stason's going to come in, and he's going to provide some feedback on the government review of those tools and templates and the quality assurance project plans as we go through to execute the program. So I've got an outline of what we're going to cover with this webinar. And so our discussion topics are going to include, we're going to start off with the NAVFAC Munitions Response RIFS guidance, and that's guidance for the remedial investigation feasibility study for both terrestrial and underwater sites. Then we're going to talk a little bit about the Intergovernmental Data Quality Task Force, their MR quality assurance project plans. So there's a couple of toolkits that they have developed. There's one for the RIFS and another one for the advanced geophysical classification. We'll then go into the munitions response scope of work templates to talk about how you can access your contractors and get scopes developed with your contractors to actually execute the work. Then go into the NAVFAC quality assessment spreadsheet, which is a way to ensure quality on our munitions response program sites. And then Stason's going to step into our munitions response quality assurance project plan document development and review of those quality assurance project plans. He's also going to talk a little bit about the remedial alternative analysis and some of our findings from the review of those remedial alternative analysis. And then talk about the review and issues with the explosive safety submissions and the after-action reports that are developed. And you see on the slide there, I'm a little bit ahead of myself in the sense that I have NOSA instruction 80-2015, and that's followed by an E. We are currently actually under the Delta version of that instruction, but I'm hoping that we get a Christmas present. So by Christmas, hopefully we will have the E version out for you folks. Let's all try and be good, I guess. Now let's start off with the guidance. So the Municipal Response RIFS guidance, we've had this for a while, but there's been a major update to it, and that was in June of 2019. And what it does is it provides an overview of the Municipal Response Program and the regulatory framework governing our investigation and the development of our response actions. It discusses roles and responsibilities of key personnel and the different offices that are involved in the Munitions Response Program. And so then on the next few slides, what I'm going to do is highlight some of the topics and content that are covered in that guidance. So there is actually a chapter on policy to lead the guidance off. And so one of the key things that is discussed in there is some overarching agreements between the Department of Defense and the EPA on the UXO management principles. And so we have agreed that we will conduct response actions when necessary to address explosive safety, human health, and the environment, and that the legal authority will be CERCLA. We'll implement it through the Defense Environmental Restoration Program, and an explosive safety oversight will be handled by the Department of Defense Explosive Safety Board. And then each service actually implements that explosive safety oversight role with its, I'll call it, representative offices. So for the Marine Corps, that is MARCOR SISCOM. For the Navy, that is the Naval Ordnance Safety and Security Activity. And we have agreed with those UXO management principles that a process consistent with CERCLA and these management principles would meet the preferred response mechanism. So essentially, for the vast majority of our sites, we're following CERCLA. So some other things that are discussed in that guidance include that a permanent record of the data gathered and a clear audit trail of that data analysis and the decisions and actions are required. And to the maximum extent practicable, That record shall include sensor data that is digitally recorded and geo-referenced. In addition, it covers such things as explosive safety, cost, and or technical limitations may limit the ability to conduct a response action and thereby limit the reasonably anticipated future land use. So a real-world example of that would be in the case of a range where a former range where they fired into a cliff face as the target area. So the rounds penetrated into that cliff face. We may not send men out there to go clean up or women out there to clean up the munitions that are stuck in that hillside or that cliff face because it's a safety issue, getting them out into that location. That doesn't mean we're not necessarily going to manage that. It means that we may have to limit the reasonably anticipated future land use around there so that we can actually go at the bottom of that cliff face, and when munitions, you know, that slough off due to erosion or those types of, call it weathering events, we can periodically go back and survey that area and make sure it's safe for folks. But we may have to, in the end, limit the reasonably anticipated future land use. So that's just kind of a real-world example of how those policy kind of things come into play in our execution of our program. So some other policies that are discussed in the guidance is the fact that NAVFAC actually has, for the last couple of years, an ESS and after-action report pre-submittal review requirement. So our explosive safety submissions require a QA review of the draft ESS and the after-action report by NAVFAC Echelon 3 personnel prior to going to NOSA or MARC or SISCOM for review. And this process is actually mandatory for EARN munitions response sites, and it's optional for BRAC sites. Other policy that is discussed in there includes our optimization policies. And so you can, this is a lot of times referred to as our remedial alternative analysis process. And so what we do is we generate a small summary of roughly about 10 pages of text with supporting figures and have that sent in for review. And what we want to do with that policy is basically get make sure that our projects all have a good potential list of alternatives that are being considered for that FS. So we do that review. So those are the things that that come into play as you go through the RIFS. There is also a chapter on the management of an RIFS. So making sure that the project team agrees on the conceptual site model, you know, the source, the pathways, the receptors, you know, what the reasonably anticipated future land use is going to be, what the general investigation approach is going to be, the objectives, et cetera. What are some of the major definable features of work associated with the site, such as, you know, vegetation or surface removal, the survey, the data collection and processing. Does this for underwater work as well? And so when you use a remotely operated vehicle or an autonomous underwater vehicle or diver operations, those kind of major operations are discussed in the planning and management of the site. It also discusses some of the considerations with explosive safety. So, you know, what is the explosive safety submission? What are the requirements for the explosive safety submission? What are ESQD arcs, explosive safety quantity distance arcs, and the implications of putting in those arcs, such as shutting down roadways to make sure that people can't enter in the areas when we're doing our work, and removing the munitions. And on the right, I've got a figure there. And when you go on the water and you do underwater operations, it's really critical to know things like wave direction, wave period, wave height, those types of things. And in the planning stage, what you want to do is look at the historical data for that area and assess what is the best time to actually minimize the effects of waves and currents and those types of things. So that's also covered in this guidance as well. And then when you get to actually execute the work, there is a chapter on conducting the terrestrial or underwater remedial investigation. So we have descriptions of what some of the detectors are, you know, for the land stuff, that is the terrestrial stuff, the advanced geophysical classification, EMI detectors, analog detectors. When you go underwater, different types of sonars, such as side scan and synthetic aperture. and how you find your position on the planet. So terrestrially, things like RTK, GPS, fiducial, RTS, robotic total station. And when you go underwater using inertial navigation coupled with DVLs, Doppler velocity logs, ultra-short baseline acoustic methods, if you're towing something, tow cable, layback calculations to find positions underwater. And then it also discusses RI processes. So things like the site survey, how you do quality assurance, how you do quality control, such things as the GSV are also discussed in that chapter. There's a chapter on MAC and MPPH treatment and reporting. And so on your slide, I've got some examples for a terrestrial site and the remedial technologies that are available to remove and treat it. And so the options would be for the removal, some type of mechanical excavation. You could have somebody hand excavating around the munition item. When you go to treat it, you know, are you going to blow it in place? Are you going to try and cover it with the material? So what type of engineering controls are you going to put in all the way on down the line? So I don't have on this slide the underwater process options, but they are actually in the guidance that we have. So that gets us to our first poll question to try and make this a little more interactive for you folks. And what I want to do is send a survey out to you, and hopefully I will get some responses back. And of course, the poll question is, what year did the EPA and the DoD agree to the UXO management principles? So send in your response. And the options are 1999, 2000, 2008, or 2018. And I'm seeing a few responses come back in, and actually the correct answer is 2000. So we'll move on. If I can get this to go back to the, there we go. Sorry about that, just a little time delay in sending those survey results out. So let's go back into the QAP toolkit and continue on with our presentation. So with the QAP, there is also a QAP toolkit that has been developed. That's another tool that we can use for our RIFSs. And this was developed by the Intergovernmental Data Quality Task Force. It's out there and it's available and is a really good starting point when you get to the RIFS. Now, the thing to remember here with this this first toolkit, Module 1, the RIFS, is it does not discuss the hazard assessment. So that's something that's still, I'll say, a little bit debatable as to what's the best hazard assessment approach for our munitions response sites, but it's an excellent tool for how you approach and do the work associated with the remedial investigation, and then also how you collect data for your feasibility study when you're trying to determine, you know, what type of cleanup is going to be done out at the site. So one of the things that it really goes into detail, and there's actually a two-day training course on this toolkit, is using a weight of evidence approach to characterize the site. So for like a typical range type of site, you might have a target area and a buffer area, a surface danger zone, something like that around the target, basically to keep folks out and keep it safe so that when we fire our munitions and use our munitions, most of them are hitting in that target area and we have a safety area around it. So what this RIFS toolkit talks about is ways to do the workflow and break it up into different, I'll call it high density areas, and that's the terminology used in the toolkit, high density areas and low density areas. And high density areas would correspond to things like targets and things like that. Low densities would be like buffer areas or other types of areas. And so what you do with the high, in this example, the high density areas, you determine whether the anomaly sources, when you go out and do the survey, whether or not they are munitions related or not munitions related. If they are munitions related, are the findings consistent with the conceptual site model? And then you go through and make sure you have enough data collected for your FS. If your findings are inconsistent with the conceptual site model, well, that means you're kind of going back into like a more of a dual loop kind of thing. You already have to revise your DQOs, and essentially you're probably going to have to go out and collect more data. And it goes on through also for the low density area, where you establish low use areas, areas where there's no evidence of munitions use, and you flow all the way on down through that workflow process. The nice thing about the toolkit is some of the worksheets that are developed for you. So these are example worksheets. You're going to have to modify them for your site-specific needs, because not every range is exactly the same. They didn't use the same munitions. They don't have the same fragmentation distances, et cetera. But it has examples, so good starting points for your things like your conceptual site model, your systematic planning process. What are your measurement performance criteria? What's the task and the schedule? How you do the sample design and the workflow? And then how do you make sure the equipment is operating properly, and meeting your QC requirements? And in the end, is the data usable for the decisions that you need to make out at the site? So there is also another toolkit developed by the IDQDF, and sometimes it comes up to the question as to which one to use. And generally, for this Module 2 toolkit, you want to use this when you're doing a remedial action and you're using advanced geophysical classification technology. It's been out for a few years and is really good for that remedial action phase of work. You can also use it in the case of doing like a non-time critical removal action, but again, you're using the advanced geophysical classification technology. Now, NAFAC, another set of tools and templates that are available for folks is the NAFAC scope of work templates. And so we have, in order for our contract actions, we have generic scopes of work already written that need to be modified for your site, for the preliminary assessment, the site inspection, for the RIFS, the remedial investigation feasibility study. We have one for small arms RIFSs, because in that case you don't have an explosive hazard there. How you do your quality assessment and contract for that action, because we do require a quality assessment on our munitions response sites. And then also an additional template for a removal action. And another kind of a tool that we can use and to help ensure quality on our sites is what's called the NAFAC Quality Assessment Spreadsheet. And what it does is, what the spreadsheet does is has a series of questions on the following processes. So it has questions on the explosive safety submission, your work plans, your QAPs for your MEC work, for your MC work, your munitions constituent work, when you're doing site prep and mobilization, site survey and grid layout, vegetation removal, surface removal, mapping, all the way on down through this laundry list of items. And so I've got an example here, a spreadsheet of questions just on the explosive safety submission. And this is an eye chart, and I think every presentation needs an eye chart just to test your vision. But I put it on there in this because actually there's over 150 questions. This is just some of the questions that are on the explosive safety submission. There's 150 questions just on the ESS alone. And so here you can see some of those questions. I've made them a little bit larger, so now we can pass our eye test. And so the first one would be like, are the types of blast overpressure protections, including personal protective measures and engineering controls, which will be employed to reduce arcs or reduce minimum separation distances, discussed? That's something that needs to be discussed in that explosive safety submission. Another question would be, are the processes by which UXO technicians will intrusively investigate and recover the munitions of explosive concern and or MPPH discussed? You've got to cover these kinds of things in that ESS. And finally, are exclusion zones for the primary and contingency munitions with the greatest fragmentation distance shown in the tables And it gets pretty specific, you know, in Section 3 included in the EZ table, exclusion zone table, in the format of Table 6.1, because our explosive safety submissions are very specific. So again, you've got just 150 on the ESS alone, but when you start going through all those different processes, we've got hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of questions to ensure quality on our munitions response sites. So that takes us to our next poll question. And I am clicking on it here. Well, we're having a little bit of the poll question isn't quite popping up on my screen, but we'll go back to the slide. And who should use the quality assessment spreadsheet? So the answers to that are, you know, is it A, the contractor's QC, B, government QA, C, the remedial project manager, D, the contractor project manager, or E, all of the above? And so I wasn't able to send that poll out to you folks, but the correct answer is actually E, all of the above. Government QA will come back and they will use that quality assessment spreadsheet to look at the quality of the work that's being performed out there and making sure that, you know, those munitions are removed and the, you know, the measurements are being correct, done correctly, et cetera. But I like to think of this as the questions that will be on the test, but it's an open book test. So the contractor QC can look at these questions, the RPM can look at these questions, the contractor's project manager can look at these questions. And so this way we can all make our munitions response site, the quality, better. You know, we don't want to find it necessarily at the government QA step. We would like to solve it when the contractor is actually doing the work. So we have high quality up front with our program. And so now I will turn it over to Stacey Martin, who's going to talk about our quality assurance project plan process.
Thanks, Brian. Yeah, so we'll talk a little bit. Brian's talked a lot about different documents and things that are documents that are related to our, you know, our program that are developed for the munitions response projects. And so we'll talk through those documents and many of the documents he's mentioned, and then also, you know, just some of the, I guess, more practical aspects of the development, and then issues we see that may help those of you that have some of these projects coming up and got documents to develop. So this first slide, so the process is listed here. I got a few steps on the slide, and these are just generally the steps that are involved. You know, your each project can be different, of course, so you may not have these exact steps. But, you know, the standard for needing a QAP for the overall projects or our SAP for the chemical sampling projects is that if you're going to collect data that's going to be used to make a decision, you need to have a QAP. So we get the question a lot from people about, do I need a QAP for, you know, this type of work or that type of work, you know, various, you know, smaller projects and things like that, or just small data collection efforts. Get the argument a lot, you know, we're just going to collect one sample, we're just going to look around, we're just going to, you know, dig a couple small holes, but, you know, that's not a good argument. If you're going to collect some data and you're going to be using that data, you need to know, you know, you got to think through the process of what we're going to do with that information. And if you find something, so if you do find UXO, what are you going to say to the regulator? What are you going to present to your stakeholders? If you don't find anything, what are you going to present to them? So you need a QAP if you're going to collect any data that's going to be used to make decisions. So the next slides here, we're going to focus on, you know, the QAP development. So the next slide talking about the QAP development. You know, as I mentioned, or Brian mentioned, there's currently two standard QAP formats, if you know, want to call it that, that are out there with the AGC and then the RIFS QAP toolkit. The RIFS QAP toolkit allows for lots of different munitions response work approaches. And if you look at that, the toolkit, you'll notice they have in the sample project, they have, I think, some AGC, they've got some MAG and DIG, they've got a whole bunch of different things in there. So Bottom line is, if you're going to use, you know, mag and dig approach in one area and you're going to use advanced geophysical classification in another, that you can put this all into one QAP. What you don't want to do is start separating out, you know, writing multiple QAPs just for the technology that's going to be used for a single effort. So your RFS, you're going to do a few different, you're going to implement a few different kinds of technologies or approaches. You want to include that all in one QAP. You don't want to separate those out. And the RFS toolkit is suitable for, you know, all the phases of work. If you're doing a site inspection, you can use that same QAP format. Even taking actions and things, the worksheets and the purpose of the worksheets, and they're applicable to many of the phases of work. So it's a good starting point, regardless of your phase of work, if you're getting ready to write a QAP for some work, for some a munitions response project. So, common issues with the QAP, you know, the first bullet, poor, no editing, that's, you're going to see that on every one of my slides when it comes to issues. I know a lot of times we use previous documents as a starting point, and we see, you know, the wrong site name, things like that. So you need to make sure you got, you know, really good, you know, proofread and really good editing on your documents. Make sure that if you have a chemical SAP or a munitions response QAP, you know, there's going to be sampling done for chemical constituents along with the munitions response work, or vice versa. If you're attaching these documents to each other or putting one as an appendix or something like that, you need to make sure when those are loaded to NIRS for review that you indicate that and make it, you know, very obvious that that's what's being done, because sometimes we've discovered an appendix for a SAP or a QAP really late in the review process, and then of course it puts your project behind schedule. Mentioned in the previous slide, AGC and other MR activities can all be in one QAP. And separate QAPs for the MR activities shouldn't be developed. Make sure you roll those all up in one QAP. So regardless of the technologies and the approaches you're using for the munitions response, put that in one QAP. Frequently we see, you know, the same reviewer will see the ESS and the QAP. That happens quite a bit. And we see different approaches. So make sure your ESS and your QAP approaches are consistent. If that means having to change one or the other, unfortunately, that's what you have to do. Don't forget to include and make sure that personnel have the MPPH training requirement in your QAPs. That seems to always be missing from the personnel requirements, and that's one that, as far as explosive safety and NOSA, they're looking for that. Investigation or removal approach, you need to be able to achieve your RAOs or your DQOs. And the most common problem is depth. So, you know, the vertical component of your project is really important. So if you can only detect the smallest item known or expected at your site to 1 foot, but you're saying you're going to clear or detect things to, you know, 2 feet or 3 feet, that's an inconsistency that needs to be addressed in your QAP to address that, your either your remedial action objectives or data quality objectives. Some more common issues. You need to have really clear if-then statements and decision criteria. In other words, if you find MEC, what are you going to do? You know, if you don't find MEC, what is going to be the decision for the site? Those are frequently missing. So that's a really important step, and it's, you know, part of the QAP process. So make sure that's in there. ESSs are not an SOP. We see that used quite a bit, that it'll, you know, a reference or a statement that, you know, our digital geophysical mapping will be conducted according to the ESS. That's not sufficient, because usually the ESSs have very, very broad description of how things are going to be done. And so you need to make sure that, you know, standard operating procedures or very detailed explanation of how you're going to conduct your various activities will be, or make sure that that's described in the QAP. You know, the ESS has all your explosive safety and, you know, those references to explosive safety and use of the ESS references and the CLAP, that's are appropriate. Step-by-step workflow descriptions, you know, preferably you have a really good flow diagram, that's given in your CLAP that says, you know, you're going to do vegetation clearance, and then you're going to do a surface clearance, and then you're going to do DGM, and then there's going to be anomaly selection, then you're going to investigate the anomaly. So that's a very kind of a very crude step-by-step that I just gave you. But if you have a flow diagram like that with your decision criteria, that's very, very helpful and also lays out that workflow process really nice. Data usability assessments, we also see a lot of kind of standard data usability assessments where people have taken from the templates or various toolkits and just kind of basically cut and pasted it and not change anything. But, you know, each site has some specific, goals and specific people that will be using the data and specific reporting that will be generated. So you need to work through that and make sure that you have a really good description of the data usability and develop a really good usability assessment. One of the things I'd like to point out is that we have seen, all the reviewers have identified that I've talked to have identified, that most of the contractors we've worked with that have really good internal quality systems checks end up with usually pretty good QAPs with minimal issues. And also a lot of the over the years contractors and people who have become really proficient at developing good SAPs usually have good MR QAPs because you're really going through the same process. You're just dealing with a different contaminant and different technologies and things. Okay, so moving on, Brian mentioned the remedial alternatives analysis for the MR projects, and the RAA goes beyond just MR projects, but for your MR projects, you need to do the RAA as well. It's really an internal check to make sure that the alternatives for your action that you're taking are well thought out and meet the, the project and Navy objectives. The second bullet, the goal of the RAA is to optimize the evaluation and selection of remedial and removal alternatives and make sure the alternatives are aligned with the remedial action objectives. So pretty straightforward purpose for the RAA. So, you need to make sure the RAA is done before you draft up your FS or ECA. The RAA should be one of the first steps in gathering some of the information, fleshing out what those alternatives are going to be. They're going to give your remedial alternatives and walk through, the various selection criteria. RAA is submitted in NIRIS, and there's a point of contact established in NIRIS for that. And then NIRIS, that point of contact, when they see an RAA come in, they will reach out to the appropriate either, multiple subject matter experts or subject matter experts for that project. The appropriate SMEs can engage through that NIRIS submittal process. So some of the common issues with the RAAs, and one of them is, AGC is, there's a huge DoD initiative to utilize the advanced geophysical classification. A lot of effort's been put into it, and it's been a very successful technology development. So you should evaluate that as part of your as part of your remedial analysis, alternatives analysis. It doesn't mean you have to use it, of course, if it doesn't suit your project, but you will probably get that question if just to make sure that it's been thought through and that that's been considered. And project managers, it's a very simple, if you're not using it, it's usually a very, the rationales are usually pretty straightforward as to why you're not using it. So, but just be aware that that is something we look for. Previously mentioned, common issue is that depth of detection, depth of clearance, how does that fit into your project? Are you able to achieve the clearance you want to achieve based on the limits of the technology that's out there? The CSM should be really clear in the remedial alternatives analysis, and that vertical component needs to be really well addressed and and fleshed out in that RAA. You need to, you know, the RAA standard format, populate the fields, you know, put in the required information, you know, make sure it's got sufficient information to evaluate everything. That said, if you end up with an RAA that's got 200-300 pages, you've done probably something more than you need to do for the RAA. The RAA should be a very concise document to look at and evaluate the alternatives to make sure that, you know, the conceptual site model, the issues at the site, the remedial action objectives are all able to be addressed with the selected alternatives. Okay, so we got a poll question here. Let's see if I can send out the poll question to y'all. Looks like it's going to work. So, the question, remedial alternatives analysis, an RAA, is required for which of the following? I didn't really talk through these items, but I did. It was on the slide. So A is a feasibility study, B is a site inspection, C, corrective measure study, or CMS, and D, an engineering evaluation cost analysis. So those are the options. And looks like we had a pretty good range here. So the correct answer is that you would do an RAA for all of these except for B. So A, C, and D require a remedial alternatives analysis. I did throw in C, a CMS, which I'm not sure how many people deal with RCRA sites, but the CMS, for, I guess, to make it describe it easy, is the equivalent of the FSM circle process, or analogous to that. So the NOSA explosive safety submission process. Brian mentioned 802015, and he had E on the front slide. I said he was a little bit anxious there and put E. Currently, we're operating with the Delta series of 802015. So E will hopefully, like Brian said, be out soon, and there may be some changes. So I'm talking, the slides I have here deal with E, so there are with D, Delta. So if there are some changes in Echo, you'll need to be aware of that. So it's good to give that a read when that comes out. So a DR is, the ESS is the explosive safety submission. There's also the determination request, ESS determination request, the DR. The DR is submitted when there's no intentional contact with MEC plan. So in other words, you're going to do something like avoidance at your site. You're not going to handle any MEC. You're not going to be digging stuff up, and you're not going to be treating MEC. That's when you would use the DR. Any of those explosive operations, like some of that I just mentioned, are planned, then you need to do the ESS. Good examples, you're going to dig, do subsurface anomaly investigations, you need an ESS. And so the process here is, you know, again, I kind of just put a few steps in here, kind of the typical way you end up getting to that ESS or the ESSDR. Every project's a little different, so, but this is generally how you would end up at the DR. You'd have a project that you know you're going to have to do a munitions response, and so you go through the scoping and cost estimating, all those things, and figure out what you're, you know, how you're going to execute the project and conduct the work, and then you would develop the ESS. So we'll focus in on that ESS development. So the big part, or the big step here, is the one on this slide. You know, the document flow, this is generally how it works. Web ESS is an automated system that NOSA has set up. There's a user manual for the Web ESS, and it is pretty good. You can walk, it walks you through the steps. Some people get a little confused the first time they're in there, but actually the user manual, if you kind of walk through that as you're doing things, you'll have, should have pretty good success. A lot of RPMs and other technical support people have used Web ESS and can, you know, help you navigate it and figure it out if you need it. So if you reach out to NOSA or to within NAVFAC, to somebody that's used it, you know, you should have pretty good luck on, again, navigating the system. NOSA is always very helpful, as I mentioned, and they can also, if there's any issues within Web ESS, they address them really quickly. They're really good about that. Some advice on using Web ESS, if you check your action tab and your interest tab, you can see the status of the document. So I always recommend after you make some, go through some step in WebESS or take some action in there, check your action tab, check the interest tab, make sure that either the group or person that's supposed to have the document next or it's supposed to be sitting with is identified in the action or interest. If it's in the action tab, it means it's yours. If it's in the interest tab, it'll tell you who's responsible at that point. There's some minor glitches where things have been, you know, documents have been submitted in, or information submitted into WebESS, and it just it's kind of out there floating around in the out in space somewhere and not assigned to anybody. And that's those have mostly been resolved. That was usually due to project sites or effects not having someone assigned to a specific role. But I haven't seen that as of late, but do be aware that that can happen. But if, again, if you check your interest tab, you would see that a document that you took an action on, if the status is blank, you'd know there's an issue, and then you can contact NOSA and figure that out. So those are the basic steps there. You're going to get a review, the pre-submittal review from Echelon 3, and you know you'll revise the ESS accordingly, and then the the process will flow back, and comments and responses will be checked, and then once it's comments have been resolved on that pre-submittal, then a draft will go to NOSA, and then it'll work through the NOSA process where you'll address any NOSA comments they may have, revise the document, and then NOSA will endorse it up to DDSB for final approval. And there's some other various steps that can take place, but the bottom line is the process is develop the draft, submit it into WebESS, pre-submittal review is done, the document's revised, sent to NOSA for review, NOSA would comment, the document's revised, and then it would be endorsed to DDSB. Okay, so common ESS issues, just like all the other ones, poor no editing, that's the big one. And we see a lot of that. Documents frequently don't follow the guidance, 802015D and upcoming E have really good standard format is laid out for the ESS, and you should just follow the sections and the information that's requested, you know, just like it says in 802015. If you do that, you've probably you've won half the battle at that point. So, you know, all the ESSs need to go through that really good edit and check against the format. NOSA used to just send documents back. They would look at them, and if they saw some of that was incorrect, they would just send it right back. And we've kind of, at the pre-submittal review stage, we've started to do the same thing because what we found is that usually if the documents don't have a lot of the basics covered up front, then they tend to have problems later on. So, you know, do a good check on the just the basics format and other things of the document before it's submitted. You know, make sure all your references and tools like TP16 is the common one, the BEM and the, you know, fragmentation data review forms. If there's any updates, make sure you're using the most recent versions. Make sure the approach makes sense and it's described logically in the ESS. QC and QA are pretty abbreviated in the ESS, but they should be, you want to have the critical elements there, and you want to have a good description of how you're going to conduct QC and QA. And then make sure your maps are easy to interpret and complete. So the 802015 instruction tells you what your maps need to have in them, and just make sure they're easy to read and easy to look at. And that's not only for the reviewer's sake, but also, you know, the ESS is a field document. You want to make sure these folks in the they're utilizing and implementing this document in the field have good information to work from. Okay, and the next item that's, you know, under NOSA's purview is the after action. And so that process there, same guidance document is 802015. You know, D here, E's coming out, keep saying that. And the guidance there gives you really good description of what the AAR needs to include. And the after action report is required for all completed munitions response actions that were done under a DDSB approved ESS. So if you have an approved ESS, at some point in time when you complete the action that's described in that ESS, you need to write an after action report. And the last bullet documents the explosive safety aspects of the selected response that have been completed in accordance with the ESS. So in other words, it's going to lay out how you conducted the work and met the requirements of the ESS or met the approach that was in the ESS. A little bit more with the after action process here. You know, the after action report basically takes everything that was related to the action and described in your ESS and just wraps everything up, how you did it, what the outcome was, and gives all that data in one concise document. You can submit NOSA under the 802015D allows you to submit other documents in lieu of an after action report, but it has to describe very clearly where each of the elements that are required for the after action report are found in that document. So if you had a construction completion report, you would have to submit, you could submit that with a crosswalk table that said, what sections of your construction completion report all the various after action report requirements are found. And then the after action report is submitted through the web ESS within 6 months of the response action being complete. So that's something to keep on your calendar. Once you finish up that work, you got to get the after action report submitted. So common issues. We haven't seen a lot of after action reports over the past, few years. I guess it's kind of the I don't want to say that the munitions response program is in its infancy, but a lot of projects are ongoing and have just been initiated over the last couple of years. So we've seen some after action reports, but not a lot. So this information is based on a pretty small sample set. One thing that I didn't put on this slide is that no after action report submitted. That's actually probably one of the biggest issues with after action reports is they just don't get submitted. And NOSA, I know, is looking at that a little closer and trying to make sure that some of the ESSs are getting closed out and that after action reports are being submitted. So another big one is we've had ESSs written and multiple contractors have done work under an ESS, which is acceptable. But if one contractor moves on and they take all this information with them and maybe don't give you everything you need for an after action report, then it's very hard for the next contractor or whoever to then develop that after action report. So, a good way to handle this for RPMs or project teams is to, if you do have a contractor moving on, somebody else is going to come in and do more work, have the current contractor develop an after action report and just do a really good internal review, get some technical expertise to review it for you. And then you can just shelf that after action report. Then when it comes time to write the final one, you're in good shape and you'll have all the information you need. And so to wrap this up, we have one final poll question. I'll send this out here. And this is an easy true false one. So an after action report is required per NOSA instruction 802015D following work conducted under an approved explosive safety submission determination request or ESSDR. And that's a true or false, like I said. So that's an easy one there. So looks like those that voted online did a pretty good job. They did not do a very good job. I have all true answers currently, and the answer is false. So an ESSDR does not require an after-action report because you're not conducting any explosive operations with that. So the after-action report is only required for an explosive safety submission that's approved through DESB. And that is all I have. Tony, back to you.
Thanks, Station. And Brian, thank you very much for participating in this. We have a couple things that we might be able to answer. To the attendees, if you have any questions for either Brian or Station, this would be the time to put it in the audience chat box. And there are a couple questions here that look kind of interesting. Brian or Station, either one of you can take this. The first one is, how do contractors get a copy of the latest FRAG database?
This is Stace, and I can take that one. You know, the BDSB has it on their website that you have to have, you know, access, and depending on, you know, your previous history and things like that, you may be able to get it through the DDSB website. But the easiest way is if you go to your RPM, the RPM can provide you with that. And then if the RPM doesn't have access or doesn't have the latest one, they can reach out to one of the, you know, subject matter experts or somebody on the work group within the Navy. So easiest way, ask the RPM and we can get that to you.
Okay. Hey, here's another one. Is there a standard AAR format?
This states again, so the after action format, 802015, lays out items that you need to address in the after action report in a sequential manner. Now, it doesn't mean you have to do it in that format, but if you were to follow the 802015 steps that are laid out, that would be a good format to follow. And the other option there again is to reach out to the RPM if they're in some of the folks within the Navy and within the work group, and we can provide you know, other after action reports that have been through review, so you can see how they were, those that have been approved, how they were formatted.
All right. This one's a little long, so let me read it to you, and then we can try answering it between one of you. Have there been more successes in achieving no further action following removal action at Navy MR sites? If so, is there any information? Whoops, excuse me. A lot of questions coming in now. I missed that one. Back up to it. Is there any information as to what the key elements were included in the MR work planning process to achieve NFA? Kind of long. Want me to read that to you again? Station, can you see the audio chat?
Yeah, I can see it in the audience chat. I have the question in front of me. But Ryan, I'll have you, you know, you can chime in here too. We've actually had the discussion a little bit here recently, but other than small arms ranges, I am not aware of a Navy site like a range or other site that had a true, you know, outside of the small arms range that has achieved no further action. There are a couple that are out there that are in the process either at the PRAP and ROD stage, but they have not been completed. Brian, is that your understanding as well?
Yeah, that is correct. And so the term that we use is not really no further action. We use UUUE, unlimited use, unrestricted exposure, when we get to a site that is that goes into the RI phase. So once you get to the RI phase, you know, you are required to evaluate that alternative, the UUUE alternative, as part of the RIFS process for that site. But Station is correct. We are in process for just a couple of our sites at this point. It's kind of, I would say it's understanding and it's an evolving process to get to UUUE. With our change in our technology, you know, using the AGC and that type of technology. So I would expect it to be used more in the future, but we're still kind of like at the, I'll call it the beginning stages of getting to that point at this right now.
All right. There's quite a few questions here. Why don't we take one more? We're running out of time a little bit, but try this one. It says, can you send out the most recent version of the RIFS guidance to NAOC?
It's actually, you will see on the, I think on the next web site, wait, there we go. We have a resources page, and I just put it up, and the MRRIFS guidance is actually out on the web, and so I have the web location broadcast right there. So, and some, there are links to some of the other resources as well. So I put up the geophysical classification documents that we discussed, and where those are located out on, like on the TNEX website. And we've also put up some locations as to where some additional training will be on those, the QAP module, the RIFS module one, And then also with our Navy training through Seacoast on the basic and advanced munitions response site management course. So you can get it there.
All right, terrific. I think that's all the time that we have questions for, so we've kind of run the clock on this. Let me wrap this up a little bit for everybody, and I'll start out by mentioning that this presentation has been recorded, and we will make the recording available to attendees. We will also answer any unanswered questions from the chat box and include that in the package that we circulate. Please, when we're finished here, complete the questionnaire at the end of this webinar. We really do rely upon the inputs that you provide us and appreciate your feedback using that ending survey. In closing here, let me note that the next OER2 webinar is going to be on quality document reviews. It's going to be presented by Paul Landon and is tentatively scheduled currently for the 16th of January, 2020. So with that, I want to thank everybody for your participation, and this ends this webinar. See you on the next one. Goodbye.